All right, Erik, well, we'll go ahead and get started. Just gave everyone a few minutes to get logged in here. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Crystal Barkas. I'm the Director of Member Engagement and Events at the Thurston County Chamber of Commerce. And welcome to Business Essentials during the time of COVID. Business Essentials is a webinar series focused on providing our community with information to help your business survive and thrive during the times of COVID. Today, we will hear from Erik Soper, owner of Clarity Business Design. He's going to be giving us an overview on some topics, such as finding opportunities in society's hard reset, tools and tactics to stand out, and how to save time and streamline. So with that, Erik, I'm going to hand this over to you. Just a couple quick housekeeping rules. If you guys have any questions throughout the presentation, please feel free to use the chat section or the Q&A. We will be monitoring both of them. And Erik has agreed to answer questions during his presentation. So with that, Erik, take it away.
All right, thank you, Crystal. Well, good morning, late morning, everyone. How are you? Happy Friday. Good to be here. My name is Erik Soper, for those of you who don't know me, and I'm the owner and operator of Clarity Business Design. Today, we're gonna be talking about some marketing stuff, and I'm super excited to be sharing with you today. I'm looking forward to seeing what we can do to help you guys position yourselves for success past COVID during these really immediate times of COVID and using technology to your advantage now and for the future of your business. So let's go ahead and dive into it. All right, let me do this. All right, a little bit about me. My name again is Erik Soper. I've been in Thurston County doing digital marketing since 2014. I own my own business, Clarity Business Design, which focuses on elevating brands to reach their best customers more effectively. And what I've been seeing in my client base over the last couple of months since COVID-19 hit is a varied response. Some people are, you know, super busy right now. So their business is spiking up in ways they can't even anticipate, while others are falling somewhere in the middle. They're still operating, but a little bit differently, and others still are just entirely flatlined and waiting for things to change again. A little bit about me, digital marketing specialist since 2014, specializing in the website design field, and my opinion for the longest time has been that the website is the hub, the core of your marketing efforts. And that is true now more than ever, but there are a lot of different ways that we can reach our ideal customers and bring them into your website. And that's not exactly what I'm talking about today. I'm talking a little bit more about big picture stuff, not just the website design, not just the website marketing and digital marketing, but how we can leverage technology to improve our brand communication style right now and build a foundation for better customer expectations. So let's talk a little bit about society's hard reset. What is a hard reset, first of all? Well, a hard reset is kind of a computer term. A lot of you may be familiar with this. If you've ever had your phone just completely stop working for you and you've tried to turn it off, but you can't. If you have to hold a combination of buttons to get that thing to finally shut down when it's completely unresponsive, that is a hard reset. And what this virus has done to our society is forced a hard reset on a lot of businesses. A lot of the systems and best practices that have been in place for generations, for decades, no longer apply as directly because everyone is working from home. Everyone's working remotely. We can't interact with each other as easily face to face. And, you know, just like a computer virus could cause a system to require a hard reset in order to solve a problem, so this virus is resetting our expectations for how business is performed in the global economy. Before COVID-19 hit, 9 to 5 hours were a standard expectation in many, many companies. We were shifting slowly away from that in a lot of different industries, but they were still expected of most employees. Face-to-face meetings were the norm. Sometimes in some companies, they were the only way that the sales team met with their prospects. Some businesses were adapting into virtual meetings really early on, but others required their staff to meet people face-to-face in restaurants, bars, coffee shops, their offices. And we are not doing that anymore. Right now, we're just kind of locked down. We're making sure to avoid as much interpersonal contact, direct contact as possible in order to make sure that our hospitals can contain the virus. Some things are really interesting to observe in the transition into digital communications. Local businesses here in this area, from what I can tell, a lot of them have had to adapt into a system that was a little bit more accessible to tech companies, to business coaches, and people who were early adopters of new ways of doing business. Tech companies, online-only businesses, an online-only business before the COVID-19 used a model that most businesses now can use to interact with their customers and leverage their teams better. And this is going to open up a lot of opportunities for you as a business owner or manager inside of a company. And I'm looking forward to sharing those with you today. After COVID-19, most businesses are, like I was saying earlier, they're closed entirely or they've slowed down and they're having to shift their operations. Face-to-face meetings are replaced with video meetings. So now, just like we are looking at each other today, although I can't see any of you, you can see me, and we're communicating through Zoom, through GoToMeeting, and through FaceTime to work on building connections without physical contact. Face-to-face meetings replaced with video meetings. Businesses who relied almost entirely on their physical presence, both in their storefronts and in their physical print marketing, are now scrambling to cobble together new solutions that move their operations online. And some are being successful at this, others are struggling. The game has changed. In a lot of ways, it's going to be a permanent change. Some things will be temporary, but we need to acknowledge that things are not going to be the same even when they return to quote unquote normal, because normal doesn't exist anymore. And just like the Great Depression left a huge imprint on the minds of the children who were raised during it, and the adults who endured it and worked through it, the generations that are observing this global event are not going to have the same view of the world that they did before. The hard reset now forces acceptance of digital business platforms, remote meetings which require no travel time or very little travel time to attend, e-commerce sales systems for product-based companies that were selling in local storefronts, and the productization of service packages for service-based companies to sell online. Does that make sense to everyone? If so, feel free to drop a note in the chat. And if you have a question, please drop that in the chat as well. Best of all, the world still doesn't know what to expect. Why do I say that's a good thing? It means that you can define new expectations for how people are going to relate and interact with your business. That's a huge change right now. And we've been watching for the last couple of months as people's fear and panic have turned into general confusion and just waiting around for the government to reopen the businesses, or waiting for the money to flow again through new business channels. But the opportunity to reset our mindset towards business and our systems approach is huge right now. And we're going to talk a little bit more about that today. Take control while you can. And I'll explain what this means. We're going to change the narrative. Bring meetings to you. This is a way that you can work on changing the narrative, changing how your customers interact with your business. A lot of the tips that I'm going to share with you today have to do with changing your level of control of the communications that are taking place in your business, in your sales and marketing process, and how that change can impact your productivity. These are tips that I've used on a personal level and tips that I've gained from my business coaching groups and from following the leading entrepreneurs online. We're going to start by using a practical tip to facilitate more meetings with your customers and more client conversations with fewer emails in your inbox. We're going to start by bringing your meetings to you with setting up a business email account. Now, I've talked about this before. Some of you have seen me in networking groups talking about why it's important to have a business email and not to use Gmail for work. In a nutshell, we want to make sure that people are associating your company name with your contact information. And so a lot of businesses still use a Gmail account or a Hotmail account, or, you know, I've even seen AOL accounts, oddly enough, for those of you who remember AOL. We want to avoid that. If you have a website, you have a domain, and we want to tie that domain to an email address which you are going to use to not only directly engage with your customers, but also to connect with online services that make it easier to communicate with your customers. So start by setting up a business email account if you can. I recommend Microsoft Office 365. That's what I use personally. I've used Google's G Suite in the past. Both of them are good solid systems that will allow you an awesome way to stay on top of your emails and keep your business separated from your personal life. John Hansman and Jeff Seaman, PC Technologies and Hands-On Technology Solutions, Only Tech Guys, they did an awesome presentation a couple weeks ago, which is on the Chamber's website and YouTube channel that you can watch if you're interested in how technology and this sort of thing will make those systems more effective for your business. But for right now, we're going to focus on the big picture approach on implementation. Once you have your business email account set up, and you should be able to do this process with a personal email, but I wouldn't recommend it. I would recommend using a business email just to keep things systemized and in their respective buckets and organized as you move forward. We're going to use a website called Calendly. Calendly is a service that you can use to automatically set up meetings over the phone, in person, and through Zoom. Right now, I recommend that you use Zoom exclusively for setting those meetings up. Zoom is the leading consumer grade and professional grade video conferencing platform that people are using right now. As I'm sure you're aware by now, it's been 2 months since people started using it almost exclusively. And Zoom and Calendly work really well together. Calendly allows you to have your Google Calendar, for example, or your Microsoft Calendar populated with all of your meetings for the week and then connected with your that's your availability. And Calendly puts that availability in front of your customers or your prospects who want to try and schedule a meeting with you, and allows them the opportunity to schedule that meeting on their own schedule. They get to see what you're available, when you're available to meet. They get to select their slot, the one that works best for their calendar. And then Calendly facilitates the meeting with Zoom so that you don't have to set up Zoom yourself or have your assistant set it up for you, someone on your team. You can just automatically allow a meeting to be generated on your calendar, and then you don't run the risk of double booking yourself. So integrating Calendly with Zoom, I'm not going to go over that exactly in this presentation. What I suggest, as with anything that having to do with technology, turn to Google or turn to an expert. I can help you with this, or PC Technologies or Only Tech Guys can help you with this as well. Once you have Calendly and Zoom connected and you have a form in Calendly built to allow your customers to see your availability, schedule their appointment, and then add the Zoom call to their calendar with the link and the password to access the video conference when it's time, you'll want to integrate Calendly into your website. You could send people to the Calendly link that they generate for you, but I find it's better in a lot of different ways to run people through your website for this. Anyone who's doing any sort of online marketing involving Facebook remarketing or Google retargeting ads is going to understand the importance of this, and I can talk about this another time. If you have specific questions about this, drop this in the chat. But putting the Calendly on your website allows you to replace the function of the semi-generic contact us form. The contact us form is so common and so easy to do these days that it's a little bit dull and repetitive, and people don't want to be entering their contact information to hopefully wait to hear from you. They want to meet with you when they're on your website or looking at your content, and they need to have an option to set up a time and emotionally invest in that time so that they have a better chance of meeting up with you and hopefully becoming a client. So integrate the Calendly into your website. This is pretty easy to do. Your website technician will be able to handle that for you. There are also all sorts of resources on Google and YouTube that can help you implement these actions. Again, we're not going to cover that here today. If you want to see what this looks like in action, feel free to visit my website, claritybusiness.design/consultation. The link is down here. And check that out. You know, see what it looks like and see how it can look and how you can customize it for yourself. You might be asking what the total cost looks like for this. And I can tell you from my experience that the maximum maximum Calendly subscription costs about $12 a month. And for a business email account with Office 365, it can be about $5 to $8 a month. Same for G Suite. And so you're looking at probably about less than $20 a month to have an automated system through which your customers can choose a time to meet with you that fits well on your calendar and on theirs. Be open to feedback, of course, on the availability, and people are still going to reach out to you by way of email, but this will allow you to reduce the back and forth that happens when you're trying to schedule meetings with people. And it'll also allow you to get a lot more information up front to help you make that meeting go well for your company. Those are things that we can talk about in another webinar. How else will these steps help you? Well, think about how much travel time you can save when your business reopens. Are you typically traveling from meeting to meeting to meeting, or trying to schedule multiple meetings at the same coffee shop back to back? All of that can be saved if you're using this sort of digital calendar, you know, automation, if you will, to hold meetings virtually and schedule them dynamically. You won't have to travel to that coffee shop. You won't have to figure out where the nearest coffee shop to your customer is or to your business. It's going to make that a lot easier. Along the same vein, think about how much money you typically spend at a coffee shop or a restaurant when you're meeting someone for a business meeting. And if finances are really tight when the economy starts to reopen, as they likely will be, you'll want to be managing those expenses for your business. And this will allow you to save there as well. Obviously, we want to support the local businesses in our community, but we need to have control over that spending when we reopen in order to bring our businesses into good financial standing after all of this is concluded. Imagine how easy it will be to maximize your productive time in the day by blocking it out from your scheduling calendar and making your meetings take place when you want them to, not when everyone else wants them to. This entire dialogue that we're having today is about regaining control of when you are accessible and how much you are accessible in order to perform better and streamline your operations so that the things that we're doing right now to adjust to a global pandemic translate into long-term results that save you time and allow you to generate more revenue for your business by extension of that available time. So when you have your productive time in the day, when you know you don't want to be interrupted, it'll be a lot easier for you to say, all right, I'm going to do meetings only at, you know, between noon and 5 o'clock. And that's when people can schedule meetings with me. Or I only take prospect meetings at 1 o'clock to 4 o'clock. And I take client meetings from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. You have that flexibility when you're using a Calendly and Zoom integration. This system is also scalable for new staff. So if you start bringing on new salespeople, or you have a team that you are transitioning into more customer-facing roles, it's going to be really easy for you to have multiple staff involved in the system, and it's going to ensure that they remain effective and productive and help them communicate better with your clients. Next, let's talk about LinkedIn. We're going to talk a little bit about how to be networking right now. Obviously, as Thurston County Chamber members, networking is really important to us. And right now, it's a little bit difficult not having those physical meetings to go where you can shake somebody's hand, you know, give someone a hug that you haven't seen in a while, talk face to face and enjoy that crowd energy. That's going to come back. But for right now, where are we going to go and network? Well, we can network in the groups that we're a member of through virtual meetings and webinars like this one. The opportunity to connect on LinkedIn, which has been around for a long time, is a lot more important now and is becoming far more prominent in business networking communities. If you're a company that's wanting to scale outside of Thurston County, this is also going to be incredibly important for you. So keep an eye out for tips that make sense when you're trying to scale outside of your local region, especially as you become more internet-based with your products and services. So LinkedIn is now the leading social media platform for business. Why is that? Because you have a platform that has been built from the ground up from the beginning to support business individuals. A lot of people have seen it as a resume builder of sorts, and for a lot of years, that's how it functioned. But with Instagram becoming highly competitive and highly driven by ads, and with Facebook becoming so cluttered with toxic political discourse, LinkedIn has become an opportunity for people who are trying to use social networking for business to connect with one another, do businesses, find employees, post jobs, and much, much more. And now it's gained traction, the traction that it really is needed from the beginning, but only early adopters have embraced. Video on LinkedIn is massive. I'm sure a lot of you have been hearing, you know, do video, do Facebook Lives, record videos, put them on Instagram, put them on YouTube, make evergreen content on YouTube. LinkedIn is awesome for video, and here's why. It's starved for content. No one is doing video on Instagram, on LinkedIn to the extent that they are on Instagram and on Facebook. So you're going to have a lot less competition, and the algorithms are going to favor your content as a result. So when we're talking about video on these social media platforms, it doesn't have to be complex. It doesn't have to be a big, fancy, expensive production. It's something that you can shoot on one of these, on your cell phone, and edit quickly with simple apps, publish, and then as you get more practiced, just like in the physical networking groups, when we're doing our 15-second, 45-second commercials or our 5-minute presentations, as you do more and more videos, you're going to gain more and more experience, and you're going to become a better public speaker, which will make a lot of things feel easier when you're trying to market yourself online. Don't try and sell people while you're in your content on LinkedIn. Facebook and Instagram have sales-heavy messages, and it works on those platforms for some industries, but LinkedIn is a little bit different. LinkedIn is about relationships and adding value to people's work lives. Entertain, inform, educate, all of that is great, and that is what bringing value really means on social media platforms. If you post a lot of content regularly, I would suggest maybe once per day or at least one article monthly, maybe a text post every day, a video post 2 or 3 times a week, based on what I'm seeing as effective for other, you know, other professionals on LinkedIn. If you focus on the information, on the education or the entertainment inside of that, that content, you're going to find that people start paying more attention, they're going to relate better with you, and when they do that in an organic way and they reach out to you through the messaging system in LinkedIn, you're going to have an easier time converting into clients, and you're not going to be appearing as that pushy sales-focused person. Do try to connect on LinkedIn with people who could buy from you, potential prospects, you know, potential buyers. Very important. Your messaging is going to be targeted towards a specific audience. And if that's the case, if you have, most of the people on your LinkedIn are people who aren't inside of your target demographics, may never buy from you, and are only there because they may know someone who could buy from you, you're going to have a hard time getting your content in front of the right people. So try and focus 80% of your connections efforts on second degree connections, people who know someone you know, who fit demographics and or job titles that have the potential to become your customers, because you're creating content for them. You are trying to help them through your media that you're producing, and it's going to be a lot more effective if it's actually being seen by those people. Unfollow people that post and engage with content that distracts you. And what's distracting the people? It will vary. But if we're on social media trying to grow our businesses, we don't want to get sucked accidentally into a conversation or topic that's not important in that time that we're using to work on our companies. What this means for everyone is going to vary, and this is going to apply to every platform that you use. If you see a post from someone that just makes you angry, it's probably best for you to unfollow. I'm not suggesting that you disconnect from them on LinkedIn or unfriend them on Facebook, but I am suggesting that you don't need to be seeing that sort of content that triggers that feeling inside, which distracts you from your purpose and from your mission of growing your company and putting out good, valuable, positive content. It's very important to keep this in mind. How will this all help you? Well, like I'm saying, live networking events will return. So at those events, you're going to be able to use LinkedIn to connect with people and show them your backlog of content that you've been producing through COVID-19. Show them the expertise and the knowledge that you've been sharing. They'll be able to check that out when they are deciding whether or not to accept your connection after they get home, or the next day, the next afternoon. And whatever you're putting out into the world will reinforce the messages that you are pushing in your sales-focused content, and it'll make it a lot easier for customers to align with you and do business with you in the long run. When it comes to LinkedIn messaging, the business professionals that I follow on LinkedIn use it like email. And email marketing is still a relevant thing. You probably get a ton of email notifications right now from companies that are marketing to you, trying to show you that they are taking steps to address COVID-19, or they're offering new promotions to make their services more accessible to people who have fallen upon hard times. LinkedIn messaging functioning as an email is awesome because, you, like I'm saying, LinkedIn is a business-focused platform, and so people who are using it are in a business mindset, which means that it's going to be a lot easier for you to connect with people in the appropriate context to move them along your sales pipeline. LinkedIn can help some businesses scale outside of the region because it is a global social media. If you have local connections, your local connections probably have regional connections who have national connections. And with LinkedIn, you have the ability to figure out who works in the industries you serve and attempt to connect with them and send them a message when you're connecting with them. So as you take your business online through COVID-19, as you start building out your e-commerce platform and making it easy for people to put money into your bank accounts so that you can solve their problems, LinkedIn will help you take this and scale it to people who may never meet you in person otherwise. Let's talk about your messaging a little bit. You need to be contrarian. You need to be selling, acknowledge that selling to everyone means effectively selling to no one. The more you can target your message to the people who are most likely to buy from you and away from the people who are least likely to buy from you, the better that messaging is going to perform. And as you measure your digital marketing, you're going to see this. Don't just expect to polarize your audience with your messages. Intend to do so. And when we say polarizing, when I say polarizing, to me, I feel that it brings up the thought of the politics of the day. The politics of the day are very polarized. You have a near 50-50 divide. A lot of people are on one side and another, and other people are on the other side. That's because both sides are polarizing their messages. They're done trying to appeal to everyone, and they are appealing to their base because they're seeing that it brings them success. The same is true for you and your business. If you are a business-to-business type of company, your messaging needs to avoid business-to-consumer type of language. And this is something that you probably already know, but I'm reinforcing it here because it's very important on LinkedIn and in any effort that you're doing through your digital marketing. We're trying to get you to stand out, which means that if you can be, if you can avoid repeating what everyone else in your industry is saying, and especially avoid repeating your local competitors, it's going to help you differentiate yourself and show people why you are the ideal choice for what you're doing. Keep in mind that there is enough business to go around. Everyone has a different approach, and we don't want to be scarcity-minded. We don't want to be stressing over, oh, X company put out this message that I was going to put out, and now they're going to attract all of my customers. That's an opportunity for you to look and see, well, maybe my messaging wasn't that unique, and maybe there's a different and better angle that I can put out there to show people why I am a good choice in contrast to this other company that put out this message. I'm using very general terms here, but I'm hoping that it is sparking the imagination for you. If you have an unpopular opinion in your industry, lean into it hard, especially if you know for a fact that following that opinion and following that knowledge and data is going to provide great results for your business. That unpopular opinion can drive controversy. Then controversy is where people get known. We know about the politicians of our time because they have created discussion. They've gathered and garnered attention. And you need to do the same in your business. Clear marketing comes from a positive definition and a negative definition combined. It is important to define who you are serving, but equally important to define who you're not serving. We don't want you wasting time pursuing the wrong customers. We want you to be spending more time pursuing the right customers who come through your automated Calendly Zoom system, get on your calendar, and use your time wisely. Leaning into an unpopular opinion creates that discussion, and it allows you to demonstrate why you believe that thing and why you are the expert that they should be listening to instead of the 500 others who are saying the opposite of what you are saying. Be less accessible and more efficient. Overall, that is the theme of what I'm trying to convey in this section. Know when your most productive work time happens in the day. Set your scheduling system and plan meetings for less productive times. This is a tip I learned from the book, The 4-Hour Workweek by Tim Ferriss. It's a great book, and a lot of the principles that I've seen in that book have been taking place organically as people are adjusting during COVID-19. I listened to this a couple of years ago on an audiobook, and this concept of using voicemail to direct people to your preferred communication is a great way to allow yourself the opportunity to turn that phone on to silent and still make sure that people are getting the communication they need from you while you are being focused on your best work. If you're able to use voicemail to direct people to your scheduling system that we put on your website with Calendly and Zoom, or to admit your administrative staff so that they can schedule an appointment for you, it's going to free you from that vibrating phone, that ringtone that you hear it going off, and you feel the anxiety of, oh, great, I need to talk to this person. Or you feel frustrated that you have to step away from the project you've been trying to dig into for days now, and you finally got some time, and then somebody calls you, and you know you're going to be distracted. Keep that from happening. Direct people to voicemail, direct people to your staff, and direct people to your scheduling system so that they can choose a time that works more for you. We are using this sort of mindset right now because the world isn't expecting us to perform in a normal fashion. The world isn't expecting us to be immediately responsive most of the time. They acknowledge that everything is up in the air. We've taken the puzzle and we've thrown that puzzle into the air, into 1,000 pieces, and they're all raining down around us, fitting into a new pattern. So take advantage of this, use this, and shift your systems accordingly with these ideas. Another great way to make your communication with your prospects and your customers easier is to use your website's frequently asked questions page. If you don't have one, now's a great time to develop one. Take the questions that people are leaving in your voicemails, sending you over email or putting into your general comments field when they are registering for a Zoom meeting with you, and build it out so that they have a self-service portal on your website. You'll get more done with fewer interruptions if you do this. You'll communicate clear expectations, which will help you to be more productive when things return to the new normal. And it will reinforce the idea in your prospect's mind that your time is valuable. You don't want to be wasting 15 minutes on a call that doesn't serve you. That's why all of this is so important. And this will allow you to serve your customers better by increasing your focus on productivity and reducing the back and forth that happens trying to set meetings with your customers and trying to figure out exactly how your calendars are going to align. This is a great time to experiment because everyone's trying new things, so you can try new things. Stick with the tried and true if you feel that you must, but I highly encourage all of you to think about what you've been wanting to try over the last few months, maybe the last couple of years, what you haven't been able to try because you haven't had the time or the resources to put into it. And now is the opportunity because in my opinion, the threshold for judgment of new systems is lower because, again, the puzzle's in the air in thousands of pieces. No one knows the rules anymore. So take advantage of the confusion, take advantage of those negative elements of the crisis and turn them to your advantage by testing new things now and seeing what people actually respond to. Let's talk a little bit about standing out now. We have about 20 minutes and I wanna have some time for question and answer. Before I go into this one, looks like Angela Kelly asks, are there any particular video editing apps that you would recommend? That's a great question. If you are in any company that has an Adobe Creative Cloud subscription, this is going to be your high-end solution. Your high-end solution is going to be Adobe Premiere Rush or Adobe Premiere Pro. If you are running a Windows machine, Windows Movie Maker is a great free solution that will allow you to trim your video clips, make sure that the video that you're showing the world makes you look like a little bit better of a public speaker than you are. You can take out some of the dead space, take out the ends and the beginnings, and make it clear and concise for your audience. On a Mac, iMovie is effective. Final Cut Pro is another option, professional grade option. But there are a lot of web apps as well, and Canva is one that comes to mind, or Adobe Spark. Those free options will usually limit your access and or provide a watermark on your content. So be careful when you're looking at that. It's not hard to find free video editing software. Your computer comes installed with it, your phone comes installed with it, and there are lots of independent apps out there. When you're looking at an app on your phone's App Store, for example, try and look for one that has a 4-star rating or higher with a lot of reviews, probably a few hundred or a couple thousand at least. That process of vetting the new software that you're looking into will help you to avoid wasting time on software that is clumsy or ineffective at what you're trying to do. Thank you for the question, Angela. All right, standing out. You have permission to be real. You have permission to be who you are and, again, polarize your audience in a good way. You want people to align with the values that your company stands for, and you want people to align with the things that are important to you in your industry. Focus on positivity, though. Be very careful not to be so strongly for something that you are putting down something else. There are plenty of people out there doing that. It is not contrarian. It is not unique to be putting down somebody else. Focus on the positivity. Focus on promoting what you are for and ignoring what you are against. Have answers if you feel like that dialogue is going to come up. But otherwise, don't worry about it. It's not going to be as big of a deal as people make it seem. Positivity always wins. What is a brand? What is your brand? We hear about brand an awful lot. We hear, oh, I need to improve my brand online, or I might need to rebrand myself. Well, a brand is not your logo, your company colors and typeface, your social media following. It's not any of that. It's not how you look. It is your reputation. Your brand is your reputation. Your brand is basically a summation of how you are perceived by the people who've done business with you and the people who haven't. If you start with the end in mind, envisioning how you want people to perceive your company, it's going to inform a lot of your decisions. So I encourage you to, during this time of crisis, try and think 6 months into the future. What is it going to look like if things get worse, if things get better? Think about 2 to 3 years in the future. What is the outcome that you want your company to end up with? Because right now you're laying the groundwork. You may be trying to survive, but it's okay to set the survival mindset aside and focus on crafting your vision for success in the future. The power of branding. True brand power comes in simple terms. It requires only a name or a logo to trigger an image of your reputation in the mind of someone who sees that logo or hears that name. It needs to be simple and concise. It needs to communicate what you stand for. And ultimately, true brand power is effective whether the audience is wanting it to be effective or not. Thinking about some of the biggest logos in the world, over here on the top right, for example, the Apple logo is synonymous with something in your mind, whether you were just thinking about Apple or not. Starbucks, same thing. By now, you're probably wanting another latte. Nike, you might be thinking about maybe you're getting new running shoes, a new gym shirt, or maybe you're thinking about Colin Kaepernick or some other athlete who's been associated with the brand. Russell Wilson, perhaps. FedEx, you're thinking about shipping. All of these are very strong, clear examples of what branding needs to look like. And you'll notice that they're all in black and white. Their color doesn't matter as much. Little pro tip, if your logo looks good in black and white, you have a better logo than those that don't. You can have this power. It takes a lot of time to build up your reputation, as I'm sure you're aware, and it's going to take a lot of intent. So when you're in creating that vision for your future, like we just talked about, think about what that's going to require, and then focus on creating those clear, distinct signals and that awesome reputation that comes to mind when people see your logo, your mark, or when they hear your company name or your personal name, if you're trying to be a personal brand. Casting a vision. Right now, like I said, a lot of us are in survival mode, but a lot of us are also looking to the future. Try to imagine measurable revenue goals for the future. Imagine measurable lifestyle goals. Do you want to be answering the phone every time it rings when business returns back to normal? Or do you want a process to be in place for that phone call to be directed to someone who can get a meeting on your calendar so that you can call them back or address their issue remotely? Imagine your measurable marketing goals. How many people are you reaching? Where are you reaching them? Is it LinkedIn? Is it Facebook? Is it in your website or in a local directory? So many options, but think about how you want to be found and who you want to find you. And again, try and look 3 to 5 years into the future, because what you do now is going to take longer to implement than you think. And if you're trying to get to the specific destination, it's going to take a little while. And I think you'll find that having that long-term projection is going to help a great deal. Your brand must serve the vision. Cut out what doesn't serve that vision. Again, think about the reputation. If you hear brand, you should think reputation. Brand, reputation. Think about the reputation that you want and ensure that your actions and your team's actions follow the path to that reputation. I use a system called AIM, which is considering the audience, image, and message. This is how you're going to clarify your marketing for the next 5-6 months while this virus gets sorted out, maybe the next year, 2 years. Hopefully it's sooner rather than later. But if you have a clear idea and a clear goal, you're going to feel a lot more empowerment in what you do every day while the virus maintains its presence in the world. First, starting off with your audience. A is for audience. Profile exercise, thinking about who you have worked with in the past. Who is your best customer? Who's your best customer in the good times? And who's been your best customer now in these really challenging times? Who has been your worst customer in these really challenging times? Crisis brings out the best in people and it brings out the worst in people. It polarizes the population. Focus on learning from those bad and those good experiences. Think about the demographics, age, gender, geography. Where are they? Who are they? What are they interested in? And why are they motivated to work with you? Break your ideal customers into what they typically buy from you, their age brackets. Are they predominantly men or are they predominantly women? That's going to be effective in your marketing. Think about their locations. Again, think about their motivations. Why are they coming to you rather than somebody else? Do the same exercise for your worst customers. Identify what they typically buy, who they are, in how old they are. Are they men? Are they women? Are they here? Are they in Tacoma? Are they 50 miles away? Are they across the world? Think about all of those different geographies that you want to serve or that you currently serve. And again, try and identify their motivations, figure out why they came to you in the first place, and try to think about why they stopped being a good customer for you or why they weren't a good customer to begin with. The more you can define your worst customers and and really dig into those pain points that you've been feeling from a management and production standpoint, the easier it will be to target your messaging positively towards the people you want to attract. Image. A is audience, I is image. Creating your image, this is typically where design starts to enter the picture. Graphic design, website design, advertisements. Your design should appeal to your audience, your ideal audiences. You should choose appropriate language for that audience. Again, this is going to depend on your industry. Do your research, talk to your customers, ask your customers for feedback, and split test your content on your website. Get professional objective guidance if you can. Right now, there are a lot of marketing experts out there that can help you with this. If you need help with this, I'm happy to schedule a brief consultation with you to figure out what sort of expert help you need. Review exercise. Describe your company, analyze your current branding content, and identify the areas where you need professional guidance. Is your website slow and cumbersome? Is your logo, does your logo look bad in black and white? Think about stuff like that and consider who can help you with all of those things. You don't have to do it all yourself. If you want to, there are tools out there to do it. It's going to take a little bit of research and a little bit of practice, but if you don't have the money and you have the time, invest the time. Message. AIM. AIM. M is for message. Define a position. What problems does your company solve? Figure out what you stand for. How does the brand relate on social issues? That's going to be important in future conversations. You don't need to focus on those social issues, but if they come up, you want to have an answer. Which emotions does your brand project? Are you peace, love, and joy? Are you strength? Are you confidence? Are you compassion? Does your company gain from dealing in local or federal politics? The reason that this question is on the list is because some companies have a vested interest in being politically involved. For example, a community solar company has a vested interest in promoting their environmentally friendly legislation. But if you don't have a vested interest in the local politics in terms of your business, it is best to avoid that if possible. People care a whole lot less about what you oppose than they care about what you support. So focus on supporting the things that you are behind and the things that you want to promote in the world. focus a whole lot less on the negativity. Business is super personal. It takes a lot to build a brand, to build a reputation, and it's incredibly important now more than ever to take the right steps to define who your best customer is, how you help them, why they should choose you over somebody else. And if you do all of this during COVID-19, you're going to come out of COVID-19 with a stronger reputation, a stronger customer base, and a stronger system for creating the results in your business that you will define as being successful. Strong messages earn loyalty. Be sure to be putting out those strong messages. And now is the time for you to build your culture, build your loyal following. If you haven't done email marketing and you want to do it, now's the time. If you haven't done video marketing and you've wanted to do it, now's the time to start. Start now, refine often, experiment, get better. The more you do these things that you've been wanting to do but putting off, the better your results will be. Thank you so much for your attention. I'm going to open it up to questions. And if you need specialized assistance, I'm happy to do that. My website is claritybusiness.design/consultation. That's where you'll see my scheduling calendar. And we will talk about how to help your business adjust through this time. It is now 12:24, which means we have a few minutes for questions. So does anyone have any that they'd like to ask? And how can I help you guys while I'm here this afternoon?
Thank you so much, Erik. We'll give it a few minutes if anybody has any questions. This was great, great content, a lot of good information. I know a lot of businesses are thinking a little bit deeper into what their marketing and digital marketing looks like right now, given that everything's so virtual. So with that, I think we answered the
question. If this was helpful to everyone, yeah, definitely. Please put it in the chat if this was helpful to you, if you find this useful, and let me know what sort of content you'd like in future presentations and content.
Perfect. We just have some comments in there. Elizabeth says, excellent presentation. And Angela, also thank you, Erik. Everybody's saying thank you. So we'll go ahead and close it out for today. Just want to thank you again, Erik, for being a panelist on the Business Essentials. And to your business, Clarity Business. And next week, our Business Essentials will pick back up on Wednesday. We're going to be hearing from the owners of TNS Cleaning, Ted and Shirley Jones. They're going to be sharing some best practices on the return and the reopening of businesses. And what does it look like for your business to be clean?